Good evening. I'm Amna Nawaz.
And I'm Jeff Bennett. On the NewsHour tonight, Donald Trump and Kamala Harris campaign in critical swing states as the vice president also sits down for her first major interview as the Democratic nominee.
Israel agrees to pause fighting in Gaza to deliver polio vaccines, while its operation targeting militants in the West Bank turns even more deadly.
And health officials warn of a deadly mosquito-borne disease that's spreading in the Northeast United States.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Carnegie Corporation of New York, working to reduce political polarization through philanthropic support for education, democracy, and peace. More information at carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. Vice President Kamala Harris and her running mate Tim Walz are campaigning for a second day in the South, holding a rally tonight in Savannah, Georgia.
Harris and Walz also sat down for a highly anticipated interview on CNN this afternoon that will air in primetime tonight. All that as former President Donald Trump continues to face criticism for his visit to Arlington National Cemetery earlier this week. Laura Barrón-López has the latest.
Vice President Kamala Harris and Minnesota Governor Tim Walz barnstorming in battleground Georgia for a second day. While in Georgia, Harris and Walz also sat down with CNN for a joint interview. For Harris, it's her first major interview since taking over the Democratic ticket, something her Republican rivals have criticized, accusing Harris of shielding herself from scrutiny.
How should voters look at some of the changes that you've made, that you've explained some of here, in your policy? Should they feel comfortable and confident that what you're saying now is going to be your policy moving forward?
Dana, I think the most important and most significant aspect of my policy perspective and decisions is my values have not changed. My value around what we need to do to secure our border, that value has not changed. I spent two terms as the Attorney General of California prosecuting transnational criminal organizations, violations of American laws regarding the passage, illegal passage of guns, drugs, and human beings across our border. My values have not changed.
That interview and rally, putting a cap on what the Harris campaign sees as an opportunity to win a state that President Biden narrowly carried in 2020. A new Fox News poll shows Harris changing the race in several toss-up states, taking a lead over Donald Trump in Georgia, Arizona, and Nevada, while narrowly trailing Trump in North Carolina. All of the polling within the margin of error. As Vice President Harris wraps up in the Sun Belt, Donald Trump campaigned today at a steel supplier outside of Lansing, Michigan. In an event billed as one about the economy, Trump railed against recent polling.
The polls are rigged, too. You know, they say Donald Trump is tied. You know, we were up massively by Biden.
But Trump's campaign is still dealing with fallout from taking video for campaign use of the former president's visit to Arlington National Cemetery on Monday. It includes moments in Section 60 of the cemetery, largely reserved for veterans of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, where photos for political purposes aren't allowed. The filming at Section 60 led to a physical altercation with a cemetery staffer. Today, the U.S. Army responded in a rare statement, saying Trump's campaign had been told that federal laws, Army regulations, and DOD policies clearly prohibit political activities on cemetery grounds. An employee who attempted to ensure adherence to these rules was abruptly pushed aside. That cemetery staffer decided not to press charges, and the Army defended that employee, who the Trump campaign accused of having a mental health episode. The Army saying, "This incident was unfortunate, and it is also unfortunate that the employee and her professionalism has been unfairly attacked." On the trail yesterday, Trump's running mate, Senator J.D. Vance, blasted Harris for the blowback Trump received, though Harris has made no statements on the incident.
She wants to yell at Donald Trump because he showed up. She can go to hell. It sounds like we've got some fans and some haters.
And today, Vance headlined a Boston firefighters convention, just a day after Tim Walz addressed the same gathering. Vance was booed when trying to defend the Trump administration's record for workers.
I want to talk about why we're fighting for working people, why we're going to fight for unions and non-union alike.
And Laura Barone Lopez joins me now. So, Laura, the full interview there that Vice President Harris and Governor Walz gave hasn't yet aired. We've only seen excerpts. So what stands out to you so far?
So in addition to what she said about her policy positions, the vice president was also asked whether or not she would appoint a Republican to her cabinet. And she said that, yes, she would, that she values diversity of opinion, that when important decisions are being made, she wants different perspectives in the room. She didn't say which Republican she's maybe considering. But I was talking to an Arizona Republican voter today, a two-time Trump voter, Amna, a woman in the suburbs who said that she liked that Harris is considering a Republican for the cabinet. She also likes that Harris is talking more and more about border security. She still is not convinced by Harris, though, Amna. And a big piece of that is that she does want more of those policy specifics. So we'll see if she gets into it a bit more in the remainder of that interview.
What you reported there, we saw Senator Vance saying Harris can go to hell. We also saw some pretty lewd sexual posts that Mr. Trump shared online about Kamala Harris, and that campaign hasn't really responded to those. Do you think they will?
No, I don't think that they will, mainly because the campaign has pretty much clearly said that they have no plans to respond to any of these attacks. So far, the vice president herself has not responded to the Arlington Cemetery incident. She has not responded herself to any of these attacks, and neither has the campaign. They haven't put out statements on it. She was asked, vice president was asked in that interview with CNN about Trump questioning her black identity, mm-hmm. and she said, "Same old playbook, next question."
Meanwhile, she continued to campaign in Georgia. They're going beyond Atlanta to more rural voters. What's the strategy there?
Her strategy is twofold, Amna. She, Kamala Harris, wants to drive up urban suburban voters, so get the Democratic base out. They appear to be coming home. But they also say that they want to cut into Trump's margins in red county. So they went to a red county in Georgia as well as in Pennsylvania in the bus tour that they did prior to the convention.
You also reported there about that race tightening in some battleground states like Arizona and North Carolina. What are you hearing from your sources on the ground in those states?
Longtime Republican strategists that I've talked to in Arizona and North Carolina say that that polling is real, that this race has completely shifted. And I also spoke to a two-time Trump voter in North Carolina today, a woman as well, who is a lifelong Republican, and she still is kind of undecided. And she said that the recent events at Arlington National Cemetery, Trump's actions, she didn't like it. She said that she felt as though he wasn't respectful. She said that she understands why he went there and the attention that he drew to Afghanistan withdrawal, but that she doesn't like that his behavior so far and feels as though that he's spiraling. So that could be something that shifts her. And it's, you're hearing, I heard also from the Arizona voter that she didn't like Trump's behavior as well at the Arlington National Cemetery incident.
All right. Laura Barone Lopez, thanks for your reporting.
Thank you.
And let's turn now to our Lisa Desjardins for an update on the Trump campaign. Lisa, it's good to see you. So as we heard, the U.S. Army issued this stark rebuke of the Trump campaign, saying that campaign staff, quote, were made aware of federal laws regarding political activity at Arlington National Cemetery. And they're confirming the reports that Trump campaign workers abruptly pushed aside a cemetery official. How is the Trump campaign responding?
Let's go through this. The Trump campaign contended that there was not a physical altercation as reported. They're not backing down from that. But at the same time, they are not supplying the video that they claim that they have to prove their case. And I will tell you, I've asked them a dozen times for that video. Now, here is the policy at the cemetery to look at it. It's very clear. This is from the U.S. military. Filming or photographing will not be permitted if it conveys the impression that cemetery officials or any visitor is endorsing any product, service, or organization. Additionally, ANC, Arlington National Cemetery, will not authorize any filming for partisan, political, or fundraising purposes. So it really wasn't an issue necessarily about families being able to do this. It was the fact that the Trump campaign had an official photographer there for campaign purposes. Now, in response to that, Stephen Chung, campaign spokesperson, put out a post yesterday with an email that they say supports their case. It does indicate that it says only Trump may have an official photographer, but Jeff, it's an excerpt. It could be talking about the visit to the Tomb of the Unknowns and not Section 60. There's different sensitivities there. Section 60 is a place of real-time grief. It is alive. It is a very sensitive area, and it is something that those officials protect particularly stringently.
I know you've been talking to Republican operatives and voters as well. What are they saying about this?
Right. Campaign staff has told me in the past that Afghanistan, the Afghan withdrawal, is something they think is one of their strongest pieces of evidence against the Biden-Harris administration. And they also know that they feel like they have strength with military causes. So there is some concern among them in the Trump universe that this dilutes that case on Afghanistan. Now, the question is, what do voters think about this? And I also spoke to some voters today. I talked to some of our deciders, those undecided voters we've been keeping track of across the country, those who are in the military. I spoke to a retired colonel from Michigan who told me he didn't really understand exactly what happened, who was wrong or right, but that he had one larger takeaway.
The bottom line for me is, why was he there now? And how is he using it? It can only be political, and that's unacceptable. Arlington Cemetery is hallowed ground. It shouldn't be used for anything personal or political.
Dave Herring says he's still not all the way on board the Harris campaign, but this pushes him farther away from the Trump campaign. I will say a different retired officer, undecided, I spoke to in Pennsylvania, pointed out he actually has more problems with Biden and Harris because of what happened in Afghanistan. He actually didn't mind the photo op for Trump. He said, oh, maybe not that great, but his problem is with the way the Gold Star families have been treated by the Biden administration.
Well, as Amina and Laura were discussing, Donald Trump is drawing fresh scrutiny for a series of lewd and rude posts on his social media account. In some ways, that's not new, but what sets this apart?
That's important. It's not new. Trump is instinctual. He is purposefully offensive when he wants to be. And what's important now is the timing of this and the key voter groups that could be affected. Particularly, let's talk about women. Now, the post that Laura and Amna were talking about involved a picture of Kamala Harris and Hillary Clinton together. And it raised Bill Clinton's affair with a White House intern when he was president. And it implied that Harris came into power by giving sexual favors. Now, that, of course, is made up, it is unfounded, and it is highly offensive to many women in general. Now, those are not new things for Trump, but these are critical weeks, and we know suburban women are a group that both campaigns believe are important everywhere, but especially in those swing states. So, while it's not clear how many voters are persuadable right now, this is the kind of thing that people who would like Trump to win but maybe are uncomfortable with him really groan about, this sort of unfiltered idea. Now, we know Trump cares because today he also announced that he would like government or insurance companies to pay for IVF services, something else that is thought of to be a concern for suburban women. So they know there's an issue there. They're trying to figure out how to get back on their feet.
Okay. Lisa Desjardins, thanks so much.
Welcome.
We start the day's other headlines with the war in Ukraine. Russian missiles and drones rained down on the country for a third time this week, causing minor damage to civilian infrastructure in Kyiv. It comes as Ukraine's top commander described fighting on the Eastern Front as exceptionally tough. Russia has ramped up its assault there since Ukraine's surprise offensive in Kursk earlier this month. Video released yesterday by Ukraine's military showed grenades dropping onto Russian targets. The EU's top diplomat today supported efforts to take the fight to Russia, including the use of Western arms.
The weaponry that we are providing to Ukraine has to have full use, and the restrictions have to be lifted in order for the Ukrainians to be able to target the places where Russia is bombing them. Otherwise, this weaponry is useless.
Also today, Ukraine's military confirmed that one of the F-16 warplanes that Western nations provided to Kyiv has crashed. It's the first reported loss of an F-16 since a handful of them arrived in Ukraine last month. In Hong Kong, two editors of a now-defunct news outlet were convicted of sedition today. Former chief editor of Stand News, Chung Kwee-kyun, was seen leaving court after the ruling. He was arrested back in 2021 along with his colleague, Patrick Lam. Their outlet openly criticized the government during a crackdown that followed pro-democracy protests in 2019. Both had pleaded not guilty to the charges. They face up to 2 years in prison each. The trial was seen as a test case for the future of press freedoms in the city. A listeria outbreak connected to Boar's Head deli meats has now claimed the lives of 9 people across the country. That's according to the CDC. 6 new fatalities have been confirmed, including 2 in South Carolina and 1 each in Florida, Tennessee, New Mexico, and New York. 3 deaths had already been reported in Illinois, New Jersey, and Virginia. 57 others have been sickened, and Boar's Head has recalled 7 million pounds of its products in what is now the largest listeria outbreak since 2011. The FBI is failing to report all suspected child sexual abuse cases to law enforcement agencies. That's according to a report out today from a Justice Department watchdog. A review of more than 300 cases between the years 2021 and 2023 found the agency did not appear to comply with mandatory reporting requirements about 50% of the time. And when the FBI did file a report, it only did so in a timely manner in 43% of cases. The inquiry stems from the FBI's failure to properly investigate former USA Gymnastics team doctor Larry Nassar. A senior FBI official acknowledged some mistakes but said the, quote, "the vast majority of the work has been handled appropriately." The Pentagon said today that Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin has agreed to provide the Secret Service with military support for presidential and vice presidential candidates. That comes after the assassination attempt last month on former President Donald Trump at a rally in Pennsylvania. At a briefing today, spokesperson Sabrina Singh said that U.S. Northern Command would provide support at various locations during the election and a bit beyond.
The Department of Defense will provide protective support and that will continue through the election on November 5th, 2024, with anticipated continued support to the president-elect and vice-president-elect through the inauguration of January 20, 2025.
The Secret Service has come under heavy scrutiny for its failure to prevent the July 13th shooting that also resulted in the fatality. Its director stepped down last month, and a number of officials have reportedly been placed on administrative leave. Fewer Americans filed for unemployment benefits last week. It's the latest sign that the labor market remains strong despite high interest rates. The number of jobless claims slipped by 2,000 from the week before to 231,000. That's a bit below expectations and still low by historical standards. A separate report out today showed the overall economy grew at a solid 3% rate last quarter. That was revised up from an initial reading of 2.8% thanks to strong consumer spending and investments by businesses. That economic data failed to lift spirits on Wall Street today, with stocks ending mixed. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained more than 240 points to close at a new record. But the NASDAQ dropped nearly 40 points as major tech companies took a breather from recent gains. The S&P 500 ended the day virtually flat. And in Paris, dozens of athletes competing in the Paralympics officially became medalists today in the first full day of the Games. The first gold went to Caroline Groot of the Netherlands in her classification of the women's 500-meter track cycling time trial. But China dominated the day, winning multiple golds in track cycling and para swimming. And a Taekwondo bronze went to Zakia Kadadi, earning the first ever Paralympics medal for the refugee team, which represents more than 120 million displaced people worldwide. Still to come on the NewsHour, criminal charges against the founder of the messaging app Telegram raise questions about free speech. Nebraska's highest court weighs whether some felons can vote this November. And a guitar virtuoso from the Sahara gets political after a coup in his home country.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Israel and Hamas have agreed to pause fighting in Gaza to allow hundreds of thousands of children to receive polio vaccinations. Those pauses will occur in specific locations for 8 to 9 hours a day over 3 days beginning on Sunday. The World Health Organization aims to vaccinate 640,000 children under the age of 10. Meanwhile, in the West Bank, at least 16 people have been killed in what the Israeli military calls counterterrorism raids that began Wednesday in the cities of Jenin, Tul Karm, and the Al-Fara refugee camp.
Among five militants, Israeli forces say they killed today in the city of Tul Karm, Mohammed Jaber, a local commander they'd long pursued. The Palestinian Islamic Jihad, a militant force backed by Iran, confirmed Jaber's death. Israeli officials say Jaber was linked to, quote, numerous terror attacks, including the June death of an Israeli man, Mdou Moctar. Jaber was killed in an overnight gun battle near a mosque, which left residents caught in the crossfire. Khalid Abu Al-Kiab says he and his wife barely escaped their home alive.
The house went up in flames as they shot three, four rockets. We broke down the bathroom window and got out. My wife's shoulder and arm were burned. Thank God it only came to that.
Meanwhile, families at the Al-Fara refugee camp buried their dead. Four killed in an Israeli raid yesterday. Masoud Naja survived that raid. Today, he buried his two children who did not. The IDF released this drone footage today, they say showing a militant base inside a mosque in the camp. Their forces have now withdrawn from Al-Fara. Also today, Defense Minister Yoav Gallant said returning Israeli citizens to their homes along the Lebanese border, where fighting with Hezbollah continues, must be a goal of the war. Just yesterday, rescued hostage Qaid Farhan al-Qadi returned to his village home near Rahat.
I feel 100%, and next to you, another 200%. Do everything you can, if it's demonstrations, everything to bring the people home from this side to the other, and from the other side to bring them back as well. For me, they are all human beings, no matter what.
His return is bittersweet. Israel has said that his Bedouin Arab village was built without permits and has plans to demolish 70% of homes there. Al-Qadi's home has not received a demolition notice.
For perspective on Israel's operation in the West Bank, we turn to Stephen Erlanger, chief diplomatic correspondent for the New York Times. He previously met with the Islamic Jihad leader who Israeli forces killed today. Stephen, welcome, and thanks for joining us. So these Israeli forces had been trying to kill Mohammed Jaber for a very long time. They actually thought that they'd done so back in April, and then he emerged alive 3 days later to kind of cult status among people there for surviving. But tell us, who was Mohammed Jaber, and why was he one of Israel's most wanted men?
Well, he was the leader of a group of militants in the Tul Karm refugee camp, and he'd organized them very well. So there was a collective of militants from Fatah, from all the other factions. And after the October 7th invasion by Hamas, they started to recruit more people, and spirited by that, encouraged by that invasion, many of them, like this kid, Abu Shuja, turned to Islamic Jihad or to Hamas away from Fatah because they felt that Hamas had actually broken through a complete stagnation in the prospect of Palestinian nationhood. And so for a lot of people, he was a hero because he kept surviving Israeli efforts to kill him, but he represented a new generation of young Palestinian militants willing to fight and die for their dream of a free and independent Palestine and to drive Israeli occupiers, as they see them, out of the West Bank.
And Stephen, just to clarify, Abu Shuja, who you referenced there, that's the nom de guerre of Mohammed Jaber. It translates to Father of the Brave. But when you met with him in person on a reporting trip to Tul Karm in the West Bank earlier this year, and he told you he'd switched allegiances from the more moderate Fatah to the more extremist Islamic Jihad, what was the reason for that? Was that just because of October 7th, or had that been building for a while?
He switched to Islamic Jihad partly because everyone among his peers have lost faith in the Palestinian Authority. They regard them as collaborating with Israel, and they've been very offended that the Palestinian Security Forces, whenever Israel would come to attack people like Abu Shuja, did not fight the Israelis, but either collaborated with them or actually stayed at home. So there's also been a growing dissatisfaction with the leader of the Palestinian Authority, Mahmoud Abbas, and also the feeling that the Palestinian state was really going nowhere, that there was a stagnation, that life looked hopeless. And as ugly as the Hamas invasion was, for many young Palestinians, it expressed a degree of hope that their own situation was not hopeless forever.
You know, we just saw today the United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres say that these Israeli raids are fueling what he called an already explosive situation in the West Bank, but he also said they could further undermine the Palestinian Authority. What do you make of that?
Well, I think the Palestinian Authority is pretty well undermined in many ways, partly through its own faults, but also through the Israeli government's decision to withhold taxes from them. And also after October 7th, they've closed the West Bank. So Palestinians who had legal permits to work in Israel could no longer go to Israel to work. And Palestinians living in Israel could no longer go to places like Jenin and Tulkarm to eat and shop. So the economy crashed, and the Palestinian Authority was already weakened. Now you have these far-right ministers inside the Israeli government who talk about annexing the West Bank, who are encouraging settlers to take more ground. So all of this does fuel more militancy and creates anxiety among the Israeli military that there will be a new wave of suicide bombings and explosives used against Israelis in Israel proper, let alone among the settlers.
Well, Stephen, as you know, Israel says the goal of this operation in the West Bank is to root out this militancy that, as you've reported on, has taken hold in many of the refugee camps there in the West Bank. Knowing what you know about that force, is that goal attainable?
Well, it's impossible to defeat an idea. This we understand, whether it's expressed by Hamas or by Fatah or by these kids. They have a dream of an independent Palestine. They have a dream of their land taken back, of Israeli settlers and occupiers gone. And there's going to be very little that Israel can do to destroy that. The idea of a two-state solution, I have to say, seems farther away than ever. And it would require giving Palestinians authority and sovereignty and control over their own lives that Israel, for its stated security reasons, is not prepared to give. So I see this third front war going on indefinitely.
That is Stephen Erlanger, chief diplomatic correspondent for the New York Times. Stephen, thank you so much. Good to speak with you.
Thank you.
Parts of New England are on high alert after health officials in New Hampshire this week confirmed the first death from the rare mosquito-borne virus known as Eastern Equine Encephalitis. It brings the total number of confirmed human infections in the U.S. this year to 6, including cases in Wisconsin, New Jersey, and the neighboring states of Vermont and Massachusetts. Meantime, hundreds of cases of another illness transmitted by mosquitoes, that's West Nile virus, have been confirmed across 33 states. It paralyzed a teenager in Missouri and hospitalized Dr. Anthony Fauci. The country's former top infectious disease expert told the outlet Stat, "I've never been as sick in my life." To help us understand more about these viruses, the risks they pose, and how they spread, we're joined now by Dr. Peter Hotez, Dean of the National School of Tropical Medicine at Baylor College of Medicine. Welcome back to the NewsHour.
Thanks for having me, Jeff.
We've now seen the first death from the Eastern equine encephalitis virus. Tell us more about this disease, how it spreads, and why New England seems to be affected by it.
Yeah, it's called an alpha virus, and we do see cases periodically, including human cases and deaths, and it tends to disproportionately affect horses, and that's where the equine part comes into the name. It circulates among birds, and there's a specific mosquito for the birds, and then once it gets hold in the birds, different mosquitoes can bite and transmit to humans. So we don't usually see a lot of cases. I think my big concern is we're starting to see, you know, not only the Eastern equine cases, but as you mentioned, the West Nile virus cases. And there's a bigger problem going on in the Western Hemisphere, where there's been this big uptick in dengue cases in Brazil, this other virus, Oropouche. We're seeing an expansion of yellow fever geography in Brazil to the fringes of the Amazon. So the big picture, I think, is that we're seeing a general surge in vector-borne diseases across the hemisphere. Brazil and parts of the Caribbean are ground zero, but it's starting to filter in, particularly in Texas and the Gulf Coast. And this could be a new normal for us during this time of climate change, together with urbanization and other factors.
Well, in parts of Massachusetts, health officials there are telling people to avoid outdoor activity between dusk and dawn. They're conducting pesticide sprays. How concerned should folks in that region be, and what more can they do to protect themselves?
Well, the problem is there's not much room for error. This is, has a high percentage of encephalitis and fatalities, perhaps as high as 30% of the cases. So this is definitely not one you want to get. I think the most important thing is if you do go outside, and especially early in the morning or in the evening, you want to be fully covered with long pants or sweatpants and socks and sneakers and, you know, a hooded sweatshirt if you're out in the morning, and a hat. And then on the exposed parts, make certain you use a good insect repellent, preferably one with a high percentage of DEET that you put on the dorsal and palmar surface of your hands and around your neck. I mean, that's what I do. I like to get my 10,000 steps in, and I do walks early in the morning, sometimes before sunrise and in the evening, which is a maximal time when mosquitoes are biting. And, you know, sometimes my neighbors who are out in shorts and T-shirts will look at me like I'm a bit nuts. And I use that as a teachable moment, and I'll explain to them, look, you have to be really careful because West Nile is accelerating right now, as well as other vector-borne diseases. And there's risk now for ones transmitted by the Aedes aegypti mosquito, including dengue, and also we have ones that are arising from Brazil. So this is the peak time of year for vector-borne disease, and it's probably going to become our new normal.
You mentioned West Nile. Let's talk more about it, because we've seen nearly 300 cases across the country. What should we know about the spread and severity of the West Nile virus?
Well, Texas is getting hit very hard. So what we usually see in the United States is a big peak in Texas and the adjoining states in the southeast, Mississippi and Louisiana, and then going up into the Great Plains. And there's North Dakota, Nebraska. And then you also sometimes see foci in New York and New Jersey, where the virus was first discovered. You have bad years and good years for reasons that we don't entirely understand. 2012 was a terrible year, for instance. And this one's looking like it could be a pretty bad year as well. And I'm worried that it's going to become more and more like this, that every year is going to become a bad West Nile year, just like we could see dengue coming into the U.S. Gulf Coast and other diseases transmitted by Aedes mosquitoes. So the West Nile is transmitted by the Culex mosquitoes. That's why we do insecticidal spraying in the evening and the morning. Aedes is a little more difficult to control. It requires going house to house, and we tend not to do that much in the United States.
Well, if this is the new normal, mosquito-borne illness made worse by climate change, what more should we be doing to protect ourselves? What more could the federal government do?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think we need to up our game in terms of doing active surveillance for these diseases. Right now, our surveillance system in the U.S. is extremely fragmented. So, for instance, if a patient comes into an emergency room or a clinic and has what kind of looks like it could be an arbovirus infection, a mosquito-transmitted virus infection, they'll present with fever and rash and headache and photophobia, being afraid of the light. And the physician kind of shrugs his shoulders doctors and say, maybe it's an arbovirus infection, maybe it's something else. And by the time you get the test back, it's days later and sometimes even longer than that because you have to send it to specialty labs. So we don't have the point of care diagnostics that we need. And what we really need to do is have a detailed map at a county by county level of what's in our particular county. And so one of the things that we're doing here at Baylor College of Medicine and our National School of Tropical Medicine, we're undertaking a pretty sophisticated metagenomics project where we're doing full sequencing of mosquitoes, the full genome together with their viruses, and also pairing it with wastewater testing. So we can get that very detailed map of what's there. So when a physician sees a patient that they suspect could have one of these infections, they'll already know what's in the flora and fauna of our local area, and we don't do that currently.
Dr. Peter Hotez, thanks as always for your insights. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
The arrest of Telegram's CEO and founder this week has reignited concerns about the balance of free speech and the responsibility that comes with running social platforms. Telegram, founded in 2013, now has more than 900 million users, making it among the most popular messaging services in the world. Stephanie Tsai has the latest.
French authorities have charged Telegram founder Pavel Durov with several offenses related to his messaging app. The charges include complicity in the distribution of child abuse images, drug trafficking, and failure to comply with law enforcement requests. Durov, who operates Telegram from Dubai, was apprehended over the weekend and was ordered to pay 5 million euros for bail. The arrest of the Russian-born tech billionaire has sparked a free speech rallying cry in some circles and has raised questions about how other social media executives may be held accountable for their platforms. Joining me to discuss the implications of this arrest is Pranshu Verma, technology reporter for The Washington Post. Pranshu, thank you so much for joining the NewsHour. Before we get into the ramifications of this arrest, tell us why Telegram is in law enforcement's bullseye and what brought about this unprecedented arrest of the company's founder.
So Telegram is a wildly popular messaging app, mostly in places like Russia, the Middle East, and South Asia. About 950 million people use it. And it's a way to send private chats or public broadcasting messages to large hundreds of thousands of people. And it's also a way to send individual kind of encrypted chats as well. So it melds two types of messaging into one app. And now, this kind of app is pretty good in some ways, for example, if you're a dissident and you want to organize a protest against an authoritarian government. But it's also become an app where some of the worst activity online kind of has become a haven for it, such as the sharing of child sexual abuse imagery. And so that's kind of what's made Telegram into the bullseyes of the French authorities now, is that they are basically saying that the owner of Telegram, Pavel Durov, is complicit in making Telegram spread child sex abuse imagery, kind of spread organized crime, and also not complying with law enforcement when law enforcement wants user data about criminal activity. And so, as you saw this weekend, this all culminated into a head when Pavel Durov landed in France outside of a Paris airport and was arrested and has now been issued charges around these types of activities.
But the other platforms, as you know, including platforms like Facebook and Instagram, have also been accused of having nefarious activities, including sexual abuse imagery of children, extremism, scammers. How is this different? How does Durov differ from his peers when it comes to that? Do the other platforms, for example, cooperate much more with governments and law enforcement?
There's no doubt that platforms like Meta and Twitter do host similar types of content. But what Telegram is very specifically known for, it actually boasts about, is its reluctance and often complete noncompliance with law enforcement in sharing user data. So even if a law enforcement official comes to Telegram, it is their policy, as they boast about even on their own site, to not share 0 bytes of data with government to date. And that's what makes it really different from all the other tech companies, is that kind of strong noncompliance.
Elon Musk and other tech giants have posted their support of Mr. Pavel on X, Musk did. And a lot of people are asking what his arrest means for the heads of other similar platforms. Should folks like Mark Zuckerberg, for example, be concerned about facing similar accusations? And could you see him being arrested if he travels to Europe? And do you see these charges being levied against a tech executive in the United States?
Yeah, you know, this is the big question here. It's opened up a can of worms. Are the people who own the tech companies liable for the content that is on their platforms? Now, in the United States, there's a rule in law that shields companies from being held liable for the content that they've put on their sites. But in Europe, there is a little bit more of a strength around holding tech companies accountable. And you've seen now, in this case, kind of the most muscular act to date of a government official, of a government holding a private official of a company to account. And it is unlikely that we would see it in the United States, where somebody like a Mark Zuckerberg or an Elon Musk is, you know, detained for what is on Facebook or on Twitter. But now the question becomes, what happens if that activity happens in Europe or elsewhere? And will governments kind of respond in kind? And we don't know the answer yet.
That is the Washington Post, Pranshu Verma joining us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The Nebraska Supreme Court heard arguments this week on whether a recently passed law which allows former felons to vote violates the state's constitution. John Yang is here with more. John?
Jeff, last month, just before this law was to take effect, Nebraska Attorney General Mike Hilgers said in a written opinion that lawmakers do not have the authority to restore the voting rights of felons who've completed their sentences. He said only the state pardon board can do that. In response, the Nebraska Secretary of State told local election officials to stop registering voters who've been convicted of felonies but not pardoned. Now the state's highest court will have the final say. Nebraska is one of 26 states in the District of Columbia that have restored former felons' right to vote to some extent or another over the past three decades. Cassidy Arena is a senior reporter at Nebraska Public Media. So, Cassidy, we had the oral arguments before the Supreme Court on Wednesday. Where do things stand now?
Well, John, that's probably a question a lot of people are asking. There's a lot of up in the air right now, especially as we wait for the Supreme Court decision. As of right now, though, the Secretary of State, Bob Evnen, has told registration offices to stop registering people who have been convicted of felonies, whether or not they have completed the two-year wait period. So the question really is, where are we now for a lot of the folks that these laws apply to for people, Nebraskans who have been convicted of felonies? It's kind of up in the air on whether or not they will be able to register to vote and to vote in this election.
Any indication when the Supreme Court's going to hand down their decision?
It's hard to tell. The Secretary of State's office obviously has some deadlines that it has to comply with, and those are coming up in October. So that's the only thing that the Secretary of State's office really needs to know in order to meet those voter registration deadlines. Other than that, it's more of just a waiting game.
You mentioned voters who registered in 2005. In 2005, there was a law passed that allowed former felons to register to vote or to vote after a two-year waiting period. And the Attorney General's opinion also addressed that, saying the legislature didn't have the right to do that. So you've had this two decades almost of people registering to vote. What's going to happen to them?
So, John, just to really outline that, there are two laws that are kind of up for question right now. The one that's 19 years old, LB 53, it basically said if you've completed your felony sentence, you've completed it entirely, and you wait 2 years, you can register to vote. Then LB 20 came in, which is the big one that really caused all of the conversation. That eliminated that two-year waiting period. So we have two then that the Attorney General did publish his opinion saying that both of them were unconstitutional. Now, the Secretary of State's office has said that the individuals who registered to vote under that previous law, that two-year waiting period law, they're not going to go and back and roll out on all of those people who registered to vote. So all of the people who registered to vote under that law, they should still be able to vote in this election. However, it is on pause for anybody who didn't get in during that kind of loophole time. So the people that already registered, they should be good to go.
Despite all this court fight, this law actually passed the legislature by a large margin. It was 38-6. Was there much debate over it there?
So there was some debate. Obviously, it did pass with a big majority. It seemed that many lawmakers did think, you know, the two-year waiting period was fine to begin with. But then with some spearheading from some other lawmakers, they decided to eliminate that. But the big thing here is, and I'm sure you all have already done your research on this as well, is the bill actually passed and became law because Nebraska allows a bill to become law without the signature of the governor. And that's kind of, that was where the questions started to sprout from.
Now, you mentioned the sort of uncertainty over what's happening with these former felons. What's the effect is this having on them, do you think?
Yeah, so there has been some estimates that around 7,000 formerly incarcerated people who have been convicted of felonies are kind of just up in the air. They really don't know if they can vote in this election. And we're getting really close to the election at this point. So it's probably a little bit disconcerting to be like, hey, do I get to vote in this election that's coming up very soon, or can I not? And so it's been a little bit disheartening for some people who this LB 20, eliminating that waiting period, it was really exciting for them to know that they could vote. And now they just don't know if that excitement was warranted or not.
The election is coming up, as you mentioned. Is anyone saying that the outcome of this case could have a political effect?
It's really hard to say. So District 2, which is the area of Omaha, the biggest city in Nebraska, it's hard to tell where that district will go. It can kind of go back and forth. Occasionally, it's known as the blue dot in the typically red Nebraska. But, you know, sometimes it can go red as well. I believe in Biden won District 2 by over 2,000. So it's hard to tell what effect it will have this election year.
And of course, this is important because Nebraska splits its electoral votes by congressional district. Cassidy Arena of Nebraska Public Media, thank you very much.
Thank you, John.
Guitarist Mdou Moctar has been bringing a new kind of music to the world steeped in his cultural heritage. Now his latest album strikes a decidedly political chord, a response to upheaval in his home country of Niger, including a military coup last year. Special correspondent Christopher Booker caught up with him on a tour through the U.S. for our arts and culture series, Canvas.
The reviews of Mdou Moctar's new album are filled with incendiary adjectives, words like fiery, blazing, and screaming. All appropriate descriptions of an album which, to Western ears, offers an entirely new demonstration of what's possible with an electric guitar. When I first sat down with Moctar 3 years ago, there was an effort underway among the press to find a proper description of this guitar prodigy from Niger. Was he the Hendrix of the Sahara, or an African Eddie Van Halen?
For me, it doesn't matter. They call me wherever they need, but I'm still Mdou Moctar, and then I'm trying all time to be me. I support, absolutely. I support Jimi Hendrix. I love what he do, and then I love Eddie Van Halen too. All the famous artists, very talented. I love them, but I love myself more. And then I'm trying all time to like have my own style.
Sung in his native Tamashek and French, Moctar's music is a contemporary iteration of what's been nicknamed desert blues, guitar-driven music performed by the Tuareg people, a traditionally nomadic group from the Sahara.
Do you worry that there's a rush to label you, to almost westernize your sound?
No, it doesn't matter. The music, like, it's, I feel the music, it's like ocean.
3 years later, after a near constant tour through the US and Europe, Moctar now stands as a singular player. Comparisons are no longer necessary.
The most important for me is to see those people happy. That is the most important, because we do the same when we have 30 person. We use the same energy with like 3,000 person.
Despite growing recognition, Moctar's musical ocean has grown more agitated, reflected both in the intensity of his playing and in the title of this new album, surrounded by the incendiary descriptions, Funeral for Justice.
When you say funeral for justice, what justice is being lost or buried?
For me, when I say the funeral for justice, I mean like the justice doesn't exist anymore. Every country like try to be strong than his neighbor. Just for what reason? Just to hurt him, to make him, I'm stronger than you. I can say whatever I need to say. No one can stop me. It's what happening in this world, and then that it's not justice. That it's not fair.
This album, though, was written and recorded before the recent upheaval in Moctar's native Niger. On July 26th, the Northern African country saw its democratically elected president, Mohamed Bazoum, a president Moctar publicly supported, overthrown in a military coup. This all happened as Moctar was on tour.
It was like, okay, we're gonna take this day by day, hour by hour, and finally when we finished the last shows, like, yeah, you guys can't go back home, the borders are closed.
Mikey Coltun plays bass in the band. He started playing with Moctar in 2017.
And so everyone was stuck in New York for a while and, you know, freaking out, calling their families, like they just want to go home to their families. And it was a very scary thing for these guys.
Moctar and drummer Soliman Ibrahim and rhythm guitar player Amadou Madassaner spent nearly 6 weeks in a holding pattern in the United States. But in October, they were able to return home, staying through the winter and early spring, before this summer's tours of the US and Europe began.
Were you worried they wouldn't be able to get back here?
Yeah, of course, always. There's always that fear. Even pre-coup, there's always the visa fear. There's, yeah, we get the visa, but then what happens? Can they get inside of the country? And there's never that sign of relief until you see them walking through the airport gates.
They did make it through this time. And the first stop was a single day rehearsal in Brooklyn, a warm-up before two shows at Coachella, California's annual mega festival in the desert outside of Palm Springs.
You sing about many things about what's going on at home. Do American audiences know what's happening back home?
Some of them, they know today what's going on. Here in the United States, the people love the music like very loud and crazy. And then I'm try again like to make them happy about what I'm playing. Later, some of them like are curious, and then they're gonna say it. I have to know what he's singing about it. And then in the same time, we have the translator for all our track in the album, and then they're gonna see it and then understand what we're talking about.
On the opening track of Funeral for Justice, also called Funeral for Justice, Moctar asks African leaders, why does your ear only heed France and America? They misled you into giving up your lands. They delightfully watch you in your fraternal feud.
This album, it's like more serious than all the albums I did before, because the problem is going like bigger than bigger. We have like to be honest, and they like punch in the face for the colonialism and tell them the truth.
What would justice look like for you?
The first thing, it is don't hurt someone because you're stronger than him. Don't drink his water because you're thirsty. It's what I call justice.
Well, personally and artistically, Moctar wrestles with the complicated geopolitics of the world. The spirit of the music is, at its core, still pure rock and roll.
You're a touring rock star at this point. You're playing all over the world. You're playing Coachella. People see you. Your life is on the road, and then it's home. Do you feel like you live in two worlds?
It's not I feel, I do.
This certainly may be true for Moctar the man, but with his guitar in hand, the contours between these two worlds are becoming just a bit more difficult to see. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Christopher Booker in Brooklyn, New York.
And there's a lot more online, including a look at financial advice on social media, when it can be helpful and when you should be skeptical. That's on our Instagram page.
And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz.
And I'm Jeff Bennett. For all of us here at the PBS NewsHour, thanks for spending part of your evening with us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Leonard and Norma Klorfein, and the Judy and Peter Bloom Kovler Foundation.
A law partner rediscovers her grandmother's artistry and creates a trust to keep the craft alive. A Raymond James financial advisor gets to know you, your passions, and the way you enrich your community. Life well planned.
The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.